Good afternoon. We're going to start, everybody. As I say, good afternoon. My name is Bill Saunders. I am a senior counsel at Americans United for Life, and also happy to be the chairman of the Religious Liberties Practice Group, which is sponsoring this luncheon. And we're very happy you could all attend. And we have a couple of breakout rooms of people who couldn't get in here, so we welcome those folks too. My only purpose here is to invite you to participate in the Religious Liberties Practice Group. You can see myself or Dean Reuter if you want to be involved or be involved in the practice group leadership. We would love to have you. And to moderate this session today, I just want to introduce a great friend of the Federalist Society, Judge Dermot O'Scanlan from the Ninth Circuit. He'll take it over from you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome to this afternoon's panel discussion. I want to thank the Federalist Society first for inviting me to moderate this distinguished panel and for choosing a timely and important topic, religious liberty after Hobby Lobby. As you're all well aware, last term the Supreme Court decided two major cases touching on religious liberty. After Congress passed the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act in 2010, the Department of Health and Human Services promulgated regulations requiring employers to provide their employees with group insurance coverage for certain contraception methods approved by the Food and Drug Administration. In Burwell versus Hobby Lobby, the court was asked to determine whether the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, or RFRA as we affectionately call it, created an exemption to this contraception mandate for closely held corporations whose owners religiously objected to providing coverage for four specific methods. The court concluded that RFRA does require such an exemption, at least for abortifacients. In so holding, the court explicitly recognized that RFRA was designed to provide very broad protection for religious liberty. The Supreme Court issued a similarly important decision regarding religious freedom in Town of Greece versus Galloway. There, the court determined that the Town of Greece's practice of opening its monthly board meetings with prayer did not violate the Establishment Clause. The court observed that such practices had been a part of our nation's rich heritage from its earliest days, and that these traditions do not run afoul of the Constitution's prohibition on religious establishment. These cases raise important questions regarding the religious freedom jurisprudence of the Roberts Court. To what extent are the religious liberty protections of RFRA coextensive with the Free Exercise Clause? To what extent do they diverge from constitutional protections? In light of the court's expansive interpretation of RFRA's protections, does the court's Hobby Lobby ruling in any way implicate Establishment Clause limits? And what nuances might have been added to the government's compelling interest and narrow tailoring requirements? In addition to raising important constitutional questions, the Hobby Lobby ruling also implicates our nation's long tradition of accommodating religion. The circuits are currently split on the question of whether RFRA entitles nonprofit organizations to additional accommodation from the Health and Human Services contraceptive mandate beyond the administration's self-certification requirement. This leads us to ask, does Hobby Lobby shed any light on how courts should evaluate such claims? More generally, what import does the Hobby Lobby decision hold for religious-based exemptions outside of the Affordable Care Act context? Hobby Lobby's broad interpretation of RFRA also raises questions as to future applications of the statute. Do RFRA's protections apply to publicly held corporations? Where else might the court's broad interpretation of RFRA have ramifications? Because Hobby Lobby was such a controversial case, will post-decision pushback influence future litigation? Well, to help us sort through these questions, we have an exceptionally capable panel assembled here today. I will introduce each briefly and direct your attention to his or her biography on the website for further details. We will hear from each panelist for opening remarks of 10 minutes each, followed by discussion among the panel members themselves, and finally, we will take your questions from the floor. Kim Colby has worked for Christian Legal Society's Center for Law and Religious Freedom since graduating from Harvard Law School in 1981. Ms. Colby assisted in Congress's passage of the Equal Access Act, which protects the right of secondary school students to meet for prayer and Bible study on campus. Her remarks will focus on legislative and public pushback to the Hobby Lobby decision. William Marshall is the Kennan Professor of Law at the University of North Carolina. Professor Marshall was Deputy White House Counsel and Deputy Assistant to the President of the United States during the Clinton administration. He has published extensively on freedom of religion, and his comments will consider the problems associated with religious exemptions more generally. Robin Wilson is the Roger and Stephanie Joslin Professor of Law at the University of Illinois College of Law. A member of the American Law Institute, Professor Wilson is a highly regarded and extensively published family law scholar. She will address the legitimacy of arguments raised in opposition to religious accommodation. With that, we will begin with Ms. Colby.
Thank you, Judge, for that kind introduction, and thank you to the Federalist Society for inviting me to be on this panel with Professor Marshall and Professor Wilson. The Hobby Lobby decision is a tremendous victory for religious liberty, and there is much to celebrate in Justice Alito's masterful opinion. I will note several aspects of the Hobby Lobby decision that deserve to be celebrated. But I also want to address why the Hobby Lobby's celebration has been muted, even somber. Why not victory dances, or even the hint of an end zone celebration after such a victory? Hobby Lobby was the third time that the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, or RFRA, had been before the Supreme Court. RFRA was enacted, of course, in 1993 in response to the court's 1990 decision in Employment Division versus Smith, which dealt a serious setback to religious liberty. Smith held that if a law was neutral and generally applicable, the government no longer had to show a compelling justification to override a citizen's religious convictions, but instead could simply require the citizen to violate those convictions no matter how easily the government could accommodate religious conscience. In response to Smith, a coalition of 68 diverse religious and civil liberties organizations urged Congress to restore substantive protection for religious liberty. Senator Kennedy and Senator Hatch led the bipartisan effort to pass RFRA in the Senate 97-3. And the House passed RFRA by unanimous voice vote. President Clinton signed RFRA into law on November 16, 1993. The first time RFRA was before the court, in 1997, in City of Bernie v. Flores, the court held that Congress lacked the authority to apply RFRA's compelling interest standard to state and local governments. But RFRA's second trip to the court was a unanimous victory. In 2006, the court heard Gonzalez versus Ocentro, in which a small religious sect invoked RFRA to protect its right to drink tea made from wasca plant leaves, a drug prohibited under federal drug laws. The court held that the federal government may not substantially burden a citizen's religious practice unless the government demonstrates that an exemption for that particular individual would actually prevent the government from achieving its compelling interest. Now, for anyone reading the wasca leaves of Ocentro, the court's broad interpretation of RFRA in its third case, Hobby Lobby, was entirely predictable. In Ocentro, the court had acknowledged that the uniform enforcement of the nation's drug laws was certainly a compelling interest. But the government failed to show that allowing an exemption for the sacramental use of wasca tea would prevent uniform enforcement. Hobby Lobby, of course, involved a different set of drugs and a different set of claimed compelling interests. But the analysis in Ocentro, when applied to the Hobby Lobby facts, to me, seemed to make the outcome inevitable. In Hobby Lobby, the government might have a compelling interest in providing all women with cost-free access to all FDA-approved contraceptives, but the government failed to demonstrate that it could not achieve this interest if a relatively few closely held businesses did not provide contraceptive coverage that violated their religious consciences. While there are many noteworthy aspects of the Hobby Lobby decision, I will quickly touch on four. First, the court held that for-profit corporations are included within RFRA's protections. And in reaching that conclusion, the court said something very significant. It ruled that its interpretation of RFRA is not cabined by the court's constitutional jurisprudence for the free exercise clause. RFRA stands on its own two feet to provide comprehensive religious liberty protection. Second, the court rejected the government's attenuation argument. Then that's the argument that Hobby Lobby and its owners were not complicit in providing drugs that violated their religious convictions because the employees decided whether or not to purchase the drugs. In language that will become a classic quote, the court responded, and I'm quoting, "Arrogating the authority to provide a binding national answer to this religious and philosophical question, HHS and the principal dissent in effect tell the plaintiffs that their beliefs are flawed," end quote. This rejection of the attenuation argument will be most helpful to the religious nonprofits' challenges to the mandate that are beginning to work their way through the courts of appeals, as we have already seen in Judge Pryor's concurrence in the 11th Circuit's grant of an injunction pending appeal in the Eternal Word television network. Third, the court correctly moved consideration of a third-party burden from substantial burden analysis to the compelling interest, least restrictive means analysis. And fourth, the court found that the government had failed, of course, the least restrictive means analysis because the government had created an alternative mechanism for the religious nonprofits in the so-called accommodation. The court did not rule whether the accommodation would satisfy RFRA, but simply ruled that it demonstrated that less restrictive means of achieving the government's interest exist. The court also noted that another less restrictive means exists. The government could assume the cost of providing the drugs for any women unable to obtain them because of their employer's religious objections. Again, the court's reasoning on this point should help religious nonprofits in the courts below because the government there has given a complete exemption from the mandate to some religious nonprofits, that is, houses of worship, while withholding the exemption from other religious nonprofits, such as Wheaton College and Notre Dame, who have the same religious objections to the same drugs. Finally, at oral argument in March, I just want to note that Justice Kennedy posed a critical question to the Solicitor General, and here I'm paraphrasing. What stops HHS from mandating that for-profit businesses include abortion in their insurance coverage? The Solicitor General had no satisfactory response. But in August, California mandated coverage of surgical abortions in all insurance plans with no religious or conscience exemptions. Washington State in the spring passed a law, the House of Washington State's legislature passed a law requiring such coverage, although it died in the Senate. And the District of Columbia seems likely to vote for a similar requirement next week. Justice Kennedy's question was prophetic. So turning now to why have the religious liberty supporters been so somber after such a significant win? Because throughout 2014, we have watched attacks on RFRA and on religious liberty itself gain new intensity. In the spring, state RFRAs were vilified in Arizona, Georgia, and Mississippi. In all three states, for the first time, we saw opposition to state RFRAs coming from big business, which is a particularly troubling development. At the federal level, immediately after Hobby Lobby, Senator Murray introduced a bill to overturn the decision. The Protect Women's Health from Corporate Interference Act of 2014 would require all employers to cover any drug or service mandated by federal statute or regulation. In the findings section of the bill, it asserts that it is intended to carry out RFRA's intent. But two paragraphs later in the operative section, it specifies that Public Law 103-141 is inapplicable. And of course, Public Law 103-141 is RFRA. On July 17th, the bill failed on a cloture vote of 56-43. Senator Reid voted in the minority for procedural reasons so he could bring it back up at a later time. So the vote really was 57 senators against religious liberty and 42 senators in favor of religious liberty. Now, it's true the bill would never have passed the House, but for 57 senators to vote to limit RFRA's protections shows the erosion of bipartisan support for religious liberty that is perhaps the severest current threat. For two decades, RFRA has stood as the preeminent federal safeguard of all Americans' religious liberty. It ensures a level playing field for Americans of all faiths by placing minority faiths on an equal footing with majority faiths. Without RFRA, a faith would need to seek a religious exemption every time Congress considered a law that might unintentionally infringe on its religious practices. And as we've seen with the HHS mandate itself, RFRA protects against administrative abuses as well. As Chief Justice Roberts wrote in Ocentro, and this is one of my favorite quotes, RFRA rebuffs the, quote, classic rejoinder of bureaucrats throughout history. If I make an exception for you, I'll have to make one for everybody, so no exceptions. RFRA maximizes social stability in a religiously diverse society and minimizes the likelihood of political divisions along religious lines. RFRA embodies the pluralistic belief that we best protect our own religious liberty by protecting everyone's religious liberty. Essentially, RFRA makes religious liberty the default position in any conflict between religious conscience and federal regulation. And I think that's as it should be for a country founded on religious liberty.
Hi, and thanks so much for the invitation. A terrific panel to be on. Thank you, Judge Scanlon. Thank you, Professor Wilson. Thank you, Kim Colby. I always love speaking before the Federalist Society. I am not, you saw that I was in the Clinton administration. I'm not exactly a typical speaker here. But one thing about the Federalist Society that I can say with all seriousness is this organization is really committed to hearing the other side. And I appreciate that. I grew up in a family where my dad, and I've said this before when I've spoken to Federalist Society events, I grew up in a family where my dad was a conservative Republican and my mom was a liberal Democrat. They let me take any position I wanted as long as I could defend it. Now, it turned out I later learned that my mom was the smarter person. But I'm actually not sure how they would come down on the issues before us today, because I agree with what Kim Colby just said about the creation of an unfortunate division on religious lines here that's going on in the culture today. But when RFRA was passed, It was a broad coalition. I'm going to come back to that in a moment. Coming from the very left and to the very right, there was an exception there, which I'll note later. I don't really think that a lot of these religion issues boil down as nicely as people would like to make them and characterize them into left-right. For example, Doug Laycock was the chief lawyer for Hobby Lobby, but he was also the chief lawyer arguing that the prayer that was upheld in Town of Greece versus Galloway was unconstitutional. You can have commitments to religion that come out in different ways depending on the context, and it really isn't as neat as people like to think. Kim said it right. The basic issue in Hobby Lobby was whether or not we were going to return to the pre-Smith regime cases, or whether or not the RFRA was going to be interpreted as giving more power to free exercise than it existed under the pre-Smith cases. When Smith was decided, there was this, again, this very strong blowback. There were a few people who said that Smith was right. I was one of them. I have my creds here. When I defend what's going on later on, I can say I defended it way back then. Last year I spoke to ACS and I said, this is what you guys asked for. So don't start complaining about a law like RFRA. But the reason why I support Smith, and which I'll get to later on, is that Smith, Justice Scalia's opinion, showed why the compelling interest test couldn't work for any length of time, and that's been the experience both under RFRA and the experience under the Free Exercise Clause, and the prediction that I'm going to make is that it's going to be very difficult to keep that level of protection of religion provided in Hobby Lobby going for any length of time just because of the dynamics that are involved with enforcing it. Now, RFRA, like most other laws, is great depending on which perspective you're in. The one group that really expressed opposition to the enactment of RFRA was the Catholic Conference. And the reason why they did was they were concerned, they thought Roe was going to be overturned, and they didn't want there to be religious exceptions to any anti-abortion requirements. So when you think about providing limited exceptions for religion, you've got to figure out what the law is. And sometimes what that law is persuades our instinctive reaction, but RFRA goes to every law, not just certain laws. The problem with the compelling interest test, I mean, in the years prior to Smith, the compelling interest test had won in 5 cases before the United States Supreme Court. 4 of them were literally the same case. Unemployment insurance compensation, and whether or not you could exclude somebody for religious beliefs if you allowed other claimants to be able to get an exception to available for work requirements. The 5th was Wisconsin versus Yoder, which was the Amish case providing an exception to compulsory education. And if you read that opinion is much more about the Amish than it is about general principles of religious liberty. At the same time, the court turned back every other claim brought before it under the compelling interest test. Justice Scalia explained why this was so in the Smith opinion. He said, first of all, the exemption is not a normal form of relief. The exemption says just certain people are excluded from a law. Normally, when you apply the compelling interest test in a speech case, the whole law is struck down. In the application of the compelling interest test to any other statute, it's just the religious adherents who are protected. So you create sort of an effect that runs against the general principle that law applies to everybody, and Justice Scalia was concerned about that. He was also concerned that anything can be religious. Any claim can be religious. If you read up the lower cases, one of my favorite ones said somebody had a religious belief that he should be able to dress as a chicken when going into court. Maybe we can test the veracity of that, but that leads to some other issues. But virtually anything, what you eat, what you wear, where you sleep, everything you do can be characterized as religion. And if you take a look at the range of religious beliefs in the country, it's an amazing amount of beliefs that exist. What it means that every single kind of activity can be characterized as religious means that every law imaginable can be subject to a RFRA challenge. And Justice Scalia was concerned about that. And then he was also concerned about how do you evaluate the legitimacy of a religious claim? How do you evaluate whether or not dressing as a chicken is real or not? Do you define religion? What's legitimate religion and what isn't? Well, that creates some sort of establishment clause issues. How do you look at the burden? Justice Alito in Hobby Lobby said you really defer to the claimant and you don't independently investigate burdens, but that pretty much means that anything can be described as a burden as well. What about sincerity? Yes, the court in a case called United States versus Ballard said you can inquire into sincerity, but how do you do that? By cross-examination? By something that looks at like an inquisitor role? Ballard also indicated that you cannot judge whether somebody is sincere by the believability of the assertion, which led Justice Jackson in that case to say, how can you do that? How can you not judge sincerity without judging believability? It's an impossible inquiry. And finally, what Justice Scalia argued in Smith was that if you apply the compelling interest test legitimately across the board, you'll weaken the compelling interest test in other areas because it's just too broad of an application. That's why he rejected the claim in Smith. And the claim in Smith was very powerful, was very sympathetic. It was Native Americans wanting to ingest peyote, and there was a lot of evidence indicating that peyote ingestion was a major part of the Native American religion, not just their religious practice, but also who they were as a culture. And he rejected that, and he was criticized heavily for it, and there were only a few who stood up and said that maybe he was right here, that maybe the law really can't stand this kind of broad attack. And by the way, the compelling interest test is particularly powerful in the religious exemption area because the state generally has a less compelling interest when applying a law to just a few people than it does when it applies to a broad class of people. So the compelling interest test means that the claimant is generally going to win, and Justice Scalia was concerned about the harm that would cause to the government interest in state. Now, in the Hobby Lobby case, there were four issues. Kim went talked about it. We don't need not do them again. I think, actually, if you took a fair look at both Justice Ginsburg and Justice Alito's opinion, both of them are supported. You can make credible arguments on the four issues, the for-profit corporation, whether you should defer to burden, what the nature of the compelling interest test should be. Justice Alito actually didn't reach that issue, and the nature of the lesser restrictive alternative. What Justice Alito does is interpret RFRA more vibrantly than Justice Ginsburg does. I think the problem that I'm talking about would happen no matter which one of these interpretations you looked at. The pre-Smith doctrine was completely mixed up. How can you restore a doctrine that everybody at the time thought was completely incoherent because of the way that it applied? And that's what the Religious Freedom Restoration Act did. But what I think is going to happen from Justice Alito's opinion, paradoxically, by providing more vibrancy to the religious claim, it's going to lead to judges having to withdraw from that commitment faster. For-profit corporations, regardless of how you deal with the issue, for-profit corporations are going to have enormous incentives to get competitive advantage by characterizing a claim as religious. They're going to be likely to win, first of all, because it's a narrower category, and they can get a competitive advantage by doing it. There was a pre-Smith claim, an attack to the minimum wage requirements of the Fair Labor Standards Act. If a claimant wins on that, they're going to have a competitive advantage over everybody that they are competing with. And if we take the argument seriously that neutrality alone isn't enough of a reason behind the government's purpose, how are they going to stop that claimant from winning? And by the way, we don't need insincere claims on this. I'm not talking about insincere claims. I want you to think for yourself for a minute, because an earlier pre-Smith case did this as well. When is a claim religious and when is it philosophical? There was a person who was objecting to working in an armaments factory, a case called Thomas versus Review Board. And the record was really unclear. He didn't want to work in an armaments factory as a Jehovah's Witness. There was nothing in the Jehovah's Witness tenets that said it's improper to work in an armaments factory. But he believed that was religious. If you read the record, it's not really clear what he believed. And my guess is a lot of us, if we thought about it, might be unclear about the derivation of particular beliefs we have. Is our belief against certain regulation based on our religious objection to it, or is it really based on the fact that we like laissez-faire? There's a case from the Sixth Circuit in which the claimant seems a little bit unclear as to whether or not he's objecting to the contraceptive mandate because of the religious part of it or because he just doesn't like government regulation. We aren't going to second guess him under Justice Alito's opinion, but it's going to lead to a lot of claims being characterized on this, which is going to lead to the pressure that at some point you have to start denying these claims, which is what's going to happen and what did happen in Smith, pre-Smith. It also happened, by the way, in the cases after RFRA was enacted and in the state RFRAs. If you take a look, and Christopher Lund has done this and Ira Lupa has done this, if you look at the record in the lower courts, it's a pretty lukewarm enforcement of the free exercise compelling interest test. So I think what the case is leading to, what the case is leading to is going to be a softening. It may very well be that Hobby Lobby will be the high watermark. I don't want to suggest by my remarks that I'm suggesting that exemptions written to particular statutes are problematic. I think you can have particular exemptions to specific statutes. But when you have a religious objection this broadly that can affect every possible law imaginable, that can be easy to raise and difficult to disprove by the government, it's going to lead to a failing jurisprudence. It's what's happened before. My guess is it's going to happen again. Thank you very much.
Professor Wilson.
Thank you. I want to thank Bill and Kim for that excellent leaping off point, and the judge for actually doing a good job with the lineup, because I'm going to pick right back up where Bill left off. He talked about the risk of withdrawing from the RFRA commitment or a commitment to generalized religious liberty protections. I want to talk about withdrawal from other religious liberty protections too, like the specific exemptions that he described. So we actually, Kim explained to us, had two big wins with respect to religious objections to the mandate. Not only the result in Hobby Lobby, which is going to pull Hobby Lobby and closely held corporations into the concessions the Obama administration extended to religious nonprofits, but those exceptions too, which were really remarkable, that we're going to dragoon and insure and make them pay for the extra sort of controversial coverage that women receive, and the employer won't pay, the women will get it, and random insurer, which we tend to hate anyhow, are going to now be made to pay. So on the heels of that, right, we have Americans saying, after two big wins, that the highest percent of Americans in a decade are seeing religion's influence is waning. That's a Pew study. So the question is, well, how can that actually be? And I think the answer is the blowback from Hobby Lobby itself. So the LA Times, maybe along with nearly every paper in America, immediately lamented that employers would now be able to assert a religious right to deny health benefits or to discriminate in miscellaneous ways, called it a dangerous precedent. But more important than even that were compromises that we had seen to build, which were around civil rights and religious liberty. For example, the Federal Employment Non-Discrimination Act as a bill finally passing the Senate after just tinkering around for a decade. And it passed the Senate in part because there was a modest religious liberty exemption in it. And 9 days after Hobby Lobby, the five groups that had supported that, especially gay rights groups, then withdrew their support for the proposed ENDA, saying that that concession would no longer be palatable. We also have seen statewide efforts to balance religious liberty with civil rights. For example, Michigan's proposed sexual orientation non-discrimination law, it has now stopped on the question of religious liberty protections. Groups say that somehow inserting those protections are inserting a, quote, license to discriminate. Even though every religious liberty, every state that has one of these kinds of laws barring discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, all 21 have religious liberty protections in them. Now, I believe that keyed up reaction to Hobby Lobby is actually conflating two very different kinds of religious liberty protections we've already described. The generalized protections that Kim and Bill have discussed, like RFRA and RLUIPA, but also what I call specific exemptions and others call specific exemptions. These are basically religious liberty protections for a particular group or belief. It's usually in a particular statute and extending an underlying civil right. So the classic example would be Title VII's provision that allows religious employers to give preference to co-religionists in hiring. Essentially, Title VII is exempting religious organizations from a duty not to discriminate on the basis of religion itself. So post-Hobby Lobby, taking a page from Scalia and Smith, as Bill said, about this idea of people being above the law, critics now say that all religious liberty protections, whether they're generalized like RFRA or specific as I just described, all of these things are get-out-of-jail-free cards, entitling the, quote, protected party to take away the rights of others. They're all bad, they say, because they risk the possibility of unfair surprise, they harm third parties, and they hamper social change. Now, these two kinds of exemptions serve similar ends, it's true, but they get there by very different means. And the fact that they get there by different means means that they implicate these sort of concerns or narratives differently. So how are these kinds of protections differently? Are different general protections like RFRA and RLUIPA test the government-imposed burden on religion against the necessity, as Kim explained, just as it happened in Hobby Lobby. By design, RFRA adjusts burdens on religious believers after the fact. So my co-author, Doug Laycock, for example, says all the time that only a law written as a standard can protect Mormons, Catholics, Jehovah's Witnesses, and Santerias and all their varied practices. Only a law written with the flexibility of a standard can provide essential protection to religious minorities, as Kim already explained to us, who sometimes have practices that are too small in scope, number of people, or too unpopular, or just misunderstood, and for that reason will not warrant protection in the political process. So, to work, RFRA almost necessarily has to work post ex post. To test whether a law or a regulation like the mandate, in fact, goes too far. But it is exactly this after-the-fact determination that makes some people, some Americans, feel like there's one set of rules for one set of people, religious believers, and another one for everybody else. Now, by contrast, specific exemptions respond to predictable, foreseeable collisions between the demands of a new social order, think the sexual orientation, non-discrimination ban, and the demands of faith in the same legislation that recognizes the new underlying civil right. Because they reach a limited universe of situations, specific exemptions are actually written as specific rules, not standards. So they necessarily are more predictable. And that kind of exemption does not allow a religious believer, I think, to be above the law. In fact, what's happening is the law is making clear the legislature's desire never to reach that religious objector in the first place. So, for example, when Congress chose to exempt the hiring of co-religionists from the general ban on religious discrimination, it was essentially choosing not to extend the duty not to discriminate to these people. Just like as Justice Ginsburg stands up for small employer exemptions in her dissent, these exemptions choose not to extend the duty not to discriminate on any basis to all employers under a certain threshold, and we know that those exemptions are in civil rights laws all over the place. So when a legislature chooses to exempt a religious belief or a practice from the scope of a new law, it is no more placing those religious believers above the law than when the legislature chooses to drop a small employer from coverage. Now, like that lawlessness narrative, which comes back out of Smith, the other post-Hobby Lobby concerns, I think, also don't have the same force in carrying over to specific exemptions. So consider the question of unfair surprise. Because most exemptions are clear on the face of the law, right? It's really hard to say, geez, I got cold-clocked by that after the fact. But even then, thoughtful legislators can actually pair a right to the religious objection with a notice beforehand, whether that is notice to one's employees that you're not going to do a particular thing, like Hobby Lobby perhaps, or notice to the public as a Catholic university that you're not going to be the place for abortions. You can actually build notice into the exemption. Advance notice actually reduces third-party harms because it allows the public to know where a provider is unwilling to assist and appropriately seek services elsewhere. Likewise, thoughtful legislators can actually condition the right to object on hardship to the public itself. which sounds like a thinning out of religious liberty, but it solves most collisions most of the time. That's exactly what Louisiana did, for example, in this piece of legislation. Finally, specific exemptions, I don't think, necessarily have to impede social progress despite the blowback from Hobby Lobby, and I'll give you two specific examples. This is a study looking at the number of abortion providers immediately after the Church Amendment, which was Congress's first health care conscience clause back in 1973, enacted just after Roe v. Wade. What this conscience clause did was protect conscience in both directions. This is your philosophical argument, perhaps, right? So doctors who thought for moral or religious reasons, hey, I can't do an abortion, they get to step off from that. But doctors who felt morally or religiously compelled to do it get to step off too. And what I mean by that is neither kind of doctor could be discriminated against in terms of the loss of staff privileges, let's say, from the local hospital. Now, lots of reproductive rights groups focus on this today to say, oh, wow, that's too much protection. But they forget that the Church Amendment led proximately to a 50% increase in the number of physicians offering abortions in their offices. And that remains an important, if small, part of access today. Now, some of you probably wouldn't see that as social progress. But the important point here is religious objections doesn't necessarily stop the trains from running. Now, deciding how a religious liberty protection will affect access is actually really very difficult. Well, we're not getting lucky here. Okay, is very difficult because religious objectors always have the what I call nuclear option. In other words, in the mandate context, what a Notre Dame, if they object to the mandate, ultimately can choose to do is to flush all of their employees onto the exchanges, which I think is actually terrible public policy. But this would be a way to solve the collision. And I think the fact that, you know, many people wanted to say the kind of crushing penalties in Notre Dame's case, it would have been about $32 million a year, oh, well, that would actually stop the religious objector in their tracks. Not so. In a recent paper, I talk about the fact that Notre Dame would actually come out ahead financially if it did that, making it an even dumber public policy. And I think this likely explains the fact that the Obama administration made so many significant concessions to religious nonprofits, which are now extended after Hobby Lobby to closely held corporations. And we see that in the original Abortion Conscience Clause II, the Church Amendment. There's this lengthy discussion in the congressional record about whether Catholic hospitals, in fact, will close their OBGYN units if they are not exempted, and they were. And this is basically a way of saying that sometimes when we protect religious conscience, we get more access, not less access, and it's wise for us to remember that. Second example about social progress is a same-sex marriage context, I hope. Hello? God bless. And I'll just talk about this very briefly. So we have seen in the same-sex marriage context that the states that have voluntarily embraced same-sex marriage have built in religious liberty protections. That doesn't happen in the courts, as you know. They do, on this first column, build them in for the clergy, which I don't really think need them because of the First Amendment. Maybe we could agree on that. But then, more importantly, they extend it to religious nonprofits in the second column, which are not required to facilitate a marriage, for example, by hosting a wedding reception or opening their marriage retreat to a marriage that they can't actually recognize. And in the third column, here's the payoff, they can't be sued or punished by the government for not getting with the new idea or the new program. Now, outside that core of protections, moving to the right on this chart, you'll see that some states protect religious social services agencies, some Catholic student housing, some the Knights of Columbus, and so on and so forth. And we can see these protections as moving out from sort of the most private religious space, starting with the sanctuary to the left, out to the interface of society, like religiously affiliated social services agencies. In the fourth ring, only one state, Delaware, has been willing to exempt state employees, in that case judges and justices of the peace, from a duty to solemnize any marriage. I actually believe they got that wrong by not qualifying the right to object by hardship to same-sex couples, but they did provide that protection. Now, exemptions allow these bills to succeed when they would not have, at least not at that moment in time. So, for example, Maryland provides a good case. Maryland tried for years, if you look at this timeline, to pass same-sex marriage with what I call fake religious liberty exemptions, limited only to the clergy. Then it got serious and added religious nonprofits. That bill ultimately failed, and then the following year, Governor O'Malley came in, enlarged the protections to include, in particular, adoption and foster care services, and it went over the line. Maryland House Speaker Bush, in interviews with co-author of mine on a new piece, basically would say of those protections that he knows for a fact that they matter to particular votes in that case. And then I'll end on these two notes. Just as in Maryland it mattered, in many, many states that voluntarily embraced same-sex marriage, there were exceedingly close vote counts, even though there was majority support for same-sex marriage that year, meaning that the religious liberty protections, in fact, mattered to the outcome. Now, that live and let live approach resonates with lots of Americans, as you can see from this poll. People on the right can get behind the idea of same-sex marriage if it has modest religious liberty protections, and they have a much tougher time if it doesn't. And my point here is not to say what we should think about these exemptions necessarily. It is to say, though, that an exemption need not threaten a larger social goal. In fact, it can support it, and we should remember that. Ultimately, I believe there is room both for generalized and specific protections, but whatever one thinks after Hobby Lobby about RFRA, it would be a shame to take down specific exemptions, too, if we find that we can't live with Hobby Lobby. Thank you.
Professor Wilson mentioned same-sex marriage. Do either of the other panelists who have not mentioned that want to say anything? All right. Any questions within the panel? Any comments? Kim, you may have some comments based on what your colleagues have said after you.
Do I need to turn this on?
I think you're on.
Okay. Bill's thought about this for a long time and written, and I just... practice, so I don't have as much on the record about this, but it seems to me that we need both legislative and judicial exemptions to really protect religious liberty. The fact that Smith certainly gave its blessing to the practice of legislators making exemptions for religion is good, and it's often a point that, at least in the beginning, we kind of missed that was a great thing that Smith left in place. But I think legislative exemptions are great, but they don't go far enough because, as the HHS mandate controversy has shown, we don't know what's going to happen after the legislation has been enacted and goes to the regulatory agencies. And also, even when the legislation is being enacted, again, the HHS mandate controversy around the Affordable Care Act gives us a lot of examples. So, you know, we have the famous quote from the Speaker of the House that the congressmen have to pass the bill before they will know what's in it. And that is, of course, not true only of the Affordable Care Act, but often what ends up becoming law has been put into the bill at the very last minute. The bill that the hearings are held on changes dramatically between the time of the hearings and the passage. And so it's really, in many ways, not practical to expect religious faiths to have a lobbyist up on the Hill who's keeping track of everything that could possibly implicate their faith. And of course, it's particularly unfair to unpopular faiths, to small faiths, or to faiths that as part of their religious beliefs, have a problem with interacting with government. There's a lot of reasons why relying solely on legislative exemptions is not enough. And I don't know exactly where Bill comes down on this, but I know I was reading an article by Chip Lupu after Hobby Lobby where essentially the argument is, well, judicial exemptions are just so messy. But I think I'd rather take my chances with messy judicial exemptions than with having no religious liberty available to me through that exemption. What RFRA does, besides help us in court when we go to litigation, what it really does, and I think this is part of what Chief Justice Roberts was referring to in the quote I read from Ocentro, is it gives you leverage with legislators, but also with the administrators, that they have to start explaining, long before litigation, hopefully, why they have a compelling interest and why another means of achieving that interest doesn't work. And that leverage is something that Smith took away that's particularly important that judicial exemptions put back into place.
Bill, a response?
Yeah, I think a few counts. I mean, I do think Kim's observation is right. Minority religions have a difficult time protecting themselves in legislatures. I think that's clearly right. That was one of the many reasons why when Smith was decided, people criticized it. They thought it would have an inordinate effect on minority religions. They don't have such a great record in front of courts either. I mean, when you come in with a belief that the judge cannot understand because it's way outside of the judge's frame of reference, they tend not to take those seriously. So there was a, you see a lot of claims, like the one I mentioned earlier, that may have been quite sincere, that are rejected by courts that are not familiar with religious traditions. They're more likely to recognize claims that are very similar to what exist in majority religious traditions. Now all of that doesn't necessarily end the question, but then when you answer that problem by saying, and literally this is what the Hobby Lobby opinion does, you can define your own right the way you constitutionally want to define it. You can claim, no matter how attenuated that might be to your core belief, providing a contraceptive device that one of your employers may or may not use violates your religious beliefs, that you can characterize that as burdening your beliefs. And I buy that, right? I'm not going to tell somebody that they don't, that what their religious beliefs are. If I think it's attenuated, they might not. They might think it's central to their religious tradition. But what you get as a result of that is you get the claimant defining their own belief. So the government cannot exclude any claims on that basis. You flip that and tell the government that they have to come up with a compelling interest in every case against what might be a limited group of believers, and the government's going to keep losing and losing and losing, and judges are going to get tired of that. They're going to see what they might think is strategic claims by people claiming things that they're not, but there's going to be a cutback. That's what happened before. That's why they rejected an attack on the FLSA. That's why they rejected a tax on state sales tax. It's too tempting to make these kinds of claims, and what Chip Lupu called as messy is that every single aspect of the inquiry, what's a compelling interest, what's a burden, are so easily manipulated one way or another that you can't provide a coherent jurisprudence out of it, which is why I really think, you know, Justice Ginsburg's opinion saying let's restore this jurisprudence doesn't make any sense because the jurisprudence didn't make any sense. 1 year before Yoder, the court rejected Gillette, which was a claim for conscientious objection for people who objected to unjust wars, i.e. Catholics, and not all wars. The court did not take that claim seriously. Next year in Yoder they did. There was no consistent pattern. So I just don't think it's going to work. It hasn't worked before. It's not going to work going forward.
At this time, we're going to open the floor to questions. I'm having some difficulty because of that light, but I do see an empty mic here, and I believe, is there another mic in the back? Please line up behind one or the other mics, and we will take your questions in the order in which you appear. Please give us your name and your hometown or organization.
Brian Walsh, the Ethics and Public Policy Center. One thing, there's sort of a narrative that I'm hearing that the anti-exemptions mantra that we're hearing now has come out of Hobby Lobby. I can tell you from being involved in about 36 state legislative battles that the anti-exemption mantra predates Hobby Lobby by quite a bit. I know Kim's been involved in some of those as well. As one example, of course, Hawaii, when it had its same-sex marriage bill, came with no exemptions whatsoever for clergy or anyone else, the first bill that went through. New Jersey as well had a state court decision that was made. I'm asking basically for a response from Professor Marshall and then also from Professor Wilson from Robin. Also in New Jersey, the state court decision overturned its same-sex marriage law. There was a piece of enabling legislation on the floor that would have had protections just for clergy. And the proponents of same-sex marriage said, no, we want no exemptions whatsoever. In addition, there have been dozens and dozens of battles at the municipal level where non-discrimination ordinances have been put in place in Ohio, in Idaho, and other jurisdictions that have no religious liberty exemptions, and they also carry criminal penalties. So this predates...
And your question is?
So my question is, first of all, what makes you think that Hobby Lobby is the issue? And second is, why is the Parade of Horribles argument relevant at this point? We've had RFRA for 20 years. Most of what you've said is going to happen has not happened for 20 years. We've had a very limited amount of litigation. Most of the instances, as you said, the plaintiffs end up losing. Why is that a bad standard if we've lived under it for 20 years and we really haven't seen the things occur? By the way, the same arguments that have been made against RFRA today were made right. 300 years ago.
I think we understand your question. Bill, do you want to try that first, and then any other members of the panel?
I'll let Robin respond to the exemption issue. The point that I was making is RFRA. I mean, what Hobby Lobby does is enforce RFRA vibrantly. It hasn't been enforced vibrantly up until now. It may go back to a lukewarm state of enforcement afterwards. I mean, that was the point I was making. In the free exercise clause, same thing. Yoder and Sherbert sounded like it was a strong protection, but it turned out not to be. And the only point that I'm making is that it's likely to return to a relatively lukewarm level. Hobby Lobby provides a higher degree of protection than I think we're seeing in the lower courts under RFRA, and also saw in the lower courts and in the Supreme Court under Smith. And the reasons for it were capably announced by Justice Scalia's opinion in Smith. He described exactly why the law had evolved the way it had.
Kim, did you want
to? Well, sure. So I appreciate the point that Brian's making, that I agree, and Robin is much more the expert on these laws than I am, but the exemptions I see generally, I just think, really, we're enacting same-sex marriage, and the best exemption we're going to get is that a minister doesn't have to perform the ceremony or it doesn't have to happen in a church. That's you know, barely the tip of the iceberg of the issues that are going to arise for religious liberty from this dramatic change in the definition of marriage. So that's very troubling. The thing that I really appreciate about what Brian's organization does is they are trying to build bipartisan religious liberty caucuses in the state legislatures. And I'll just go back to a theme I sounded. We need bipartisanship on this issue if it's at all possible. I don't know if it is. One of the really troubling things that we saw and maybe is blamed on Hobby Lobby, I don't think so, but the timing might say it is that, as Robin referred to, INDA passed the democratically controlled Senate literally a year ago today with some significant religious liberty protections. Religious organizations were exempt, and then also there was an additional language that they were protected from conditions or withdrawals of their tax exempt status and other things as well. It was a strong piece. The president in May or June said he was considering the executive order to protect LGBT rights in hiring by federal contractors, and that was issued in July, of course. And he kind of said, I'm open to hearing whether it should have religious liberty protection. A number of us asked for the same religious liberty protection that had passed the Democratic-controlled Senate just a few months before, and those protections were not included. So it's a very troubling time where we're seeing, I think, a hardening against religious liberty exemptions within the Democratic Party that's very troubling for the future of religious liberty.
Robin, did you have a comment?
Just a quick one. Brian, I agree with you, obviously. There has been a slow ratcheting up. And you were absolutely right. Lambda Legal pulled their support after, you know, had very bitterly said we do not want the religious liberty exemption that was in the bill, by the way, that Governor Christie vetoed, right? I think a lot of people would like to have that back now. And that's actually one of the risks. If you don't bargain and embrace voluntary same-sex marriage, you are going to get a judicial decision, which is what I call the black hole state. You're not going to get any new protections out of the judiciary. It's not their job, really. So you're going to have to get them from the legislature. And I think in this particular case, people probably regret now that they did not. That said, there has obviously been a ratcheting up, Brian. I mean, even in my original remarks, I was going to call it a collective freak out, but then I thought that's not dignified. But that is what happened, right? We have had a collective freak out about the cost of it. And I think one of the reasons, I haven't thought this through, maybe Bill or Kim have a better sense of it, but I think one of the reasons is this isn't some cute little religion like the Amish, and or is the state coming down on the Amish too hard by saying they can't have steel wheels on their buggies or something like that? We're now talking about majoritarian beliefs getting a quote pass, right, in a way that has a ripple effect for many, many people. And so I think that just is sort of a news flash. A kind of awareness a calibrating between religious liberty and the social state that happened, but that people haven't had to sort of be aware of or realize the cost of it. So that's the acceleration after Hobby Lobby, that it somehow got personal. It wasn't marginal and minoritarian anymore. It's majoritarian, and I think that's where some of the problem is.
Next question from the floor.
Hi, John Eastman, Chapman Law School and the Center for Constitutional Jurisprudence. I always like to kind of get down to the foundational principles on these things, and there are a couple of aspects of this case that forces us to confront a couple of things. The Bill of Rights is always phrased in recognizing pre-existing fundamental rights, not giving them. And the fact that we had to rely on RFRA at all means that these religious freedoms exist only by the grace of government. That seems odd to me. I know how we get there, but it ought to force us to reconfront, I think, Employment Division versus Smith. The second piece of this is not a use of a religious exemption to prevent somebody from causing harm to others. This is taking money from A, giving to B, robbing Peter to pay Paula, if you will. And you know, this underlying violation of that basic principle of the social compact, all of the reaction to the case, it just ignores what's really going on here. Is there any way to re-engage those foundational conversations, maybe by way of this case or others similar to it? In other words, should we have a Freedom Restoration Act, not just a religious freedom restoration?
Bill?
John, somehow I think you're not really talking about RFRA there, but on the first part of your claim, on the first part of your claim, the question of whether the Free Exercise Clause authorized exemptions, there was a great colloquy on that by two members of the Federalist Society. Michael McConnell said yes, and Philip Hamburger said no when they took a look at the historical evidence. It doesn't seem, I think, if you read Philip's piece closely, I think he's got the better of the argument about whether the framers anticipated exemptions as a relief for particular burdens on religious liberty, and there are a lot of reasons why that might be the case. With respect to the question of whether you want me to stand up here and defend the Affordable Care Act, I don't think that's the nature of this panel. I think that I do believe that we have a commitment to equal opportunity in this country, and it's a very strong one, and one of the things I share with this organization is a great belief in individual freedom. I do not think you have access to that individual freedom when you are sick.
Well, I'll Robin? Take a crack. So, Dean Eastman, you know, I'm very sympathetic to the fact that you should not have to go to the government and ask for this favor. That said, that's where you got left after Smith. That's the world we are in. And if we don't recognize that and stay in front of it, there are going to be all these repercussions, I believe. Now, I'm very sympathetic also with what Kim said. That's a high task, right? You'd have to be aware of everything going on all the time. And really, a lot of the tension here is over just the degree and size of the administrative state, that they could even push into something as intimate as contraceptives and who's paying what for whom, for Paula, to use your metaphor, I think is really deeply problematic. On the other hand, once we got there, right, I think it was incumbent to try to find solutions that did not, for example, say, we don't think this is, you're not saying this, I realize that, but we don't think this is an important issue, because collectively it's been decided to be an important issue. And I do have sympathy with the IOM report when they say this is a women's access issue, it's a gender participation issue. And I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for the folks that want to bracket this and say, geez, you know, this is a funding problem, not an access problem. Because if you don't have $20 for a pill pack, that is an access problem. So at some point, if we want to be able to garner those religious protections in the process, we have to get real about the reality of the administrative state and engage that, and then say, how can we step off without getting in the way of what that greater project is? And if we can't articulate that, then we aren't going to get the grace of government, and it's just going to get worse.
Next question.
Hi, Paul Johnson. Two quick questions. First to Professor Wilson, I was wondering, in the wake of the Hobby Lobby decision, there was a lot of hysteria, both in the media and even among my friends, about the rights being taken away, et cetera. I was wondering, if there were no slavery or no war or 14th Amendment and civil rights movement, would we be here today? Would there be some sense that I'm being discriminated against because I don't get pills, or I have, you know, I'm being discriminated against because they won't bake a cake for my same-sex marriage, that sort of thing? Second question, you mentioned before that, you know, 2 decades ago there was, if you use Congress as an index, that it was a moral consensus that religion generally should be protected, and that seems to have whittled away to a large degree. What happened, and did that acceleration of change take place on January 20th, 2009?
Could I ask you again to just say the first question, because I'm not sure I got the tail end of it.
Oh, okay. I guess I'll try to just speed it up again.
I'm sorry.
No problem. The Hobby Lobby decision, there was a lot of hysteria.
Right.
At least I perceive it that way, both in the media and just people I know. And the question I have is that there seems to be an entitlement of, I guess, sort of rights generally. I'm just wondering, because of obviously the history of blacks in the country with slavery and the civil rights movement, has that sort of opened the door for people to feel entitled to all sorts of other rights, like, again, having a baker bake a cake at your same-sex marriage, and if they don't bake the cake, they're going to sue you because they're discriminating against you because you're homosexual, that sort of thing.
Okay.
Did that give you enough to go on?
I got it.
Okay.
Okay. You know, it's interesting. After today, I'm going to the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act, a conference that's at Boston University. And one of the things that I want to talk about there is the Civil Rights Act and an exemption buried in it for Miss Murphy. Y'all remember Miss Murphy? She's a lady who runs a boarding house who was exempted from the Civil Rights Act and later the Fair Housing Act if she had an owner-occupied house and she could rent 4 rooms and occupied one of them. In the Civil Rights Act, 5 rooms. And she was posited to be a bigot. Miss Murphy didn't want black people living in her house. And we let her step off in the Civil Rights Act. And the reason we did it is because it was a part of a package of sweeteners that allowed that underlying victory, right, of public access to public commercial services to be realized. Now, the Civil Rights Act was sort of unique because there were so many things going on at the time, not the least of which was President Kennedy's assassination. But when you got to the Fair Housing Act, people like Walter Mondale said explicitly, it was better to cut off one slice of the loaf and get the rest than to have nothing, right? And we exempt people sometimes that we disagree with. And this is how religious people are going to be seen to some extent in the modern debates about same-sex marriage. We have to articulate a reason why it's good and decent to let Mrs. Murphy step off. I think it's good and decent because it's her home. And even if she wants to be a bigot, that's her house and that's her prerogative. I think it's good and decent because she has the right to decide who she associates with. I think it's good and decent because I don't like the government over so much, and I certainly don't want to give the government a whole lot more power over me. So I think there are really good reasons why we do that. And it's important that those kind of compromises have been stable and enduring. So last year, I don't know if you would know this, but the Pew Foundation looked at ask people, how do y'all feel about interracial marriage? And in 1964, when we adopted the Civil Rights Act, I think it's something like 10% of Americans, might have been 13, said we don't really care. Last year, it was 89% of Americans don't care about interracial marriage. I actually think we get to a world where people don't care about that stuff faster if we don't make religious martyrs, right? If we don't crush people even if we can, than when we do. And so I think, you know, this is an evolving enterprise. How do we figure out how we live together with each other in a decent way? And I think the exemptions get us there.
Okay, question, next question, please.
Yes, my name is Francois. I am the chair of the French chapter of the Federalist Society. And to answer your question, Judge, my hometown is Paris.
Welcome, Francois. Good to see you.
Thank you. My question is to the panel is this one. We Europeans are very interested in your very sophisticated case law about religious freedom. My question is, how do you manage religious freedom versus living together? I mean, just in a few words, you know that in our country, we prohibited the burqa, you know, the veil, and we won the case before the court of Strasbourg in July. And we did that not only for security reasons, but to protect living together, what we call non-material order. If you belong to a society, you cannot hide your face, because in the Western civilization, face is very essential to us. So between living together and religious freedom, we have made a choice, which is living together. What would be your opinion on this? Thank you.
You know, that's not accommodating religion to make us living together. I mean, I think that's the argument you're making, which is the antithesis of the previous question, I think. Are we not sympathetic enough to religion? I think what we do is we have a pretty good compromise. You know, the question about are we anti-religious now, that came from the previous questioner. He was suggesting that there's been an attack on religion. The primary separationists in American history were the evangelicals, not Jefferson. They were the ones who argued that the worst thing for religion was to be supported by the state. That's where our tradition came from on that. It's not this pro-religion, anti-religion, and I think there's a false dichotomy here. I mean, the example I used with Doug Laycock's a real one. He believes that the best way to protect religion is to not have government prayers and allow accommodations such as that found for Hobby Lobby. I think a lot of us can disagree of the best way to do it. I don't think the approach that France took with the no accommodation is a good one. I think it leads to the kind of blowback that Robin talked about. I think there's some that we should have. And fortunately, as a country, we've been able to deal with this for quite a while, not always successfully. People killed each other over which version of the Ten Commandments was going to be displayed, because the Catholic and Protestant ones are very different. But somehow we've learned how to develop a little bit on that, and I think the instinct that we have that not letting government get too involved with religion is helpful.
Well, thank you. We certainly, as Bill was saying, we chose to go a different way than France a long time ago. And unfortunately, I think, I know that some of the voices that are speaking in at least academic circles, I was at a Harvard Law School symposium called Religious Accommodations in an Age of Civil Rights. And this was in early April of this year. And it's available on YouTube if you want to watch some of that same idea articulated, which is that there is a common good, and the state will define what that common good is, and the common good does not include religious accommodations. It's a very scary thought. I hope it reflects very few of the people in academia, but these views are being voiced out there that we just are going to have religion in church or synagogue or mosque and in your homes, but you don't get to take it with you out into this, the public square or into your commercial activities. And I think we chose a different way 400 years ago. But unfortunately, every generation has to keep choosing that way. We have to keep choosing pluralism. We have to keep choosing free speech. We have to keep choosing religious liberty. And it's this generation in particular, I'm afraid, is having a very difficult issue with that. I do a lot of work, and many of you know me, and thought, how long can she go without talking about campus access issues? But that's what Cal State and Vanderbilt and Bowdoin are all about, is this idea that has taken hold in the educational institutions that they don't have to accommodate the religious people. They'll set up their own orthodoxy, and if you won't comply with it, you have to leave campus. So, you know, yet again, and this kind of goes back to John Eastman's question, we just have to keep educating the next generation that America is about pluralism, and it's about letting each of us identify ourselves even within our religion in a very public way.
Robin, did you have something?
No, thank
you. All right, next question, please.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Downs. I'm a 1L at Regent University School of Law. I noticed Ms. Colby mentioned how the celebration of the victory of Hobby Lobby was very muted and somber, and I've noticed that too. So I was wondering if you could maybe expand upon that, and I'm wondering if it has to do with maybe the religious liberty component of Hobby Lobby wasn't so popular, especially among young people, and how to make that more popular. Thank you.
Kim?
Well, just very quickly, I think we were all very concerned by what we saw during the time around Hobby Lobby about the state RFRAs. This push on making abortion part of some of the insurance plans, as someone already may have mentioned, you know, Hobby Lobby is a religious liberty case, but it also has to be understood, obviously, in this broader context in which the mandate, the HHS mandate, is a sharp departure from a 40-year tradition that Robin was talking about of where we've all along since Roe versus Wade said that we're not going to force people to participate in abortion against their conscience. And the HHS mandate departed from that, and I think that's part two of the soberness around the Hobby Lobby case. Is it was sort of like, are we really having to fight about this? We really are going to compel people who have religious objections to these drugs to pay for them.
Can I say
oh,
just
yes,
a word?
Oh, yes, Robin.
So, well, one, applaud Beckett, right, for case selection on this, because it is significant that the first case to get to the Supreme Court was about abortifacients and not just the objection, I think, to contraceptives. So I think they're really to be credited for that. That was a good move. But I want to go back. We've been talking a little bit about Arizona and the state RFRA fights that did not go well. And I just want to say two things about it that may go a little bit back to Francois's question. I lost track of where he went. But about living together in a plural society. One of the things that happened in Arizona is you had people say, well, gee, we have to have this expansion of the state RFRA, which was already in place, to cover sort of commercial groups because we, quote, need to stave off gay rights. There were literally people in the Washington Post, religious believers, saying that. Now, if we set up religious liberty as a straight-up contest with other values in our society, you can almost be assured that you're going to lose, at least when that other value is LGBT rights, partly because of our young lady, you know, the younger generation, right? I mean, this is, whoop, the civil rights issue of the, you know, of their lives. And as I say in a new paper, that's just going to get worse, like if you look at the demographic shifts. But I also think what's really important is there were no gay rights to stave off in Arizona. There was no statewide non-discrimination statute, and that matters, right? Because those protections that I diagrammed coming out of the voluntary same-sex marriage laws are responses to the fact that there's a non-discrimination statute that preceded the embrace of same-sex marriage. And what that meant was that religious groups that wanted to participate with the government in contracts, right, they wanted to have equal access to be contract partners, could be denied that because of statutes that, and policies that were put in place really about other things that are not so deeply religious. And that's a reason that it has to be clarified in the law. These non-discrimination statutes, which I think are important, are about burgers and taxis and large commercial apartment buildings. They were never about marriage. They were never about a uniquely religious sacrament. But that said, if the fight as we go forward in now what would have been red states until recently, until the Supreme Court's denial of cert, which turned most of the country blue for purposes of same-sex marriage, if people say things like, we have to have religious protections because now gay people have rights, that is going to be a losing proposition. So I think we have to think harder about why those religious protections are necessary. They're not really from marriage equality. They are from those underlying non-discrimination statutes spilling over to things that I think they were never intended to do. But I would hate to see this whole debate become Arizona. That would not be good.
Next question.
I had a question for the panel about free exercise challenges.
A little louder, please.
Sorry. I had a question for the panel about free exercise challenges, because one of the points I think you all made was that after Smith, those challenges have gotten significantly harder even than they were before. Has RFRA, especially as kind of bolstered by both the Ocentro decision and the Hobby Lobby decision, made people less inclined to challenge laws under the free exercise clause as not neutral and not generally applicable? In other words, has it reduced the incidence and strength of free exercise challenges by having the RFRA option available instead?
Anyone want to try that?
I haven't looked at that empirically, but Hobby Lobby and Conestoga raised the free exercise claim of unequal treatment as well as the RFRA challenge. And if I'm a lawyer bringing one of these claims, I'm going to raise both of them, and I'm going to look for some way to argue that the challenge law is not a neutral law of general applicability. You know, they won that. You know, the challengers won that in one case, the Hukami Babalu. But my guess is that RFRA that the Smith decision sends a signal that you're pretty sympathetic to the government's position that it is a neutral law of general applicability, and then you have RFRA as the backup. So a court that wants to avoid a constitutional issue is going to do exactly what the court in Hobby Lobby did and decide on the statutory claim and not reach the constitutional claim.
I think at the federal level, you're definitely going to go with RFRA unless it's a Hosanna Tabor type of case where it's church autonomy, and Hosanna Tabor, of course, was not, there's no balancing test, as RFRA has a balancing test. The free exercise, federal free exercise claim will still come into play as to state and local laws.
Next question.
Right. Brian Bishop from the Stephen Hopkins Center for Civil Rights in Rhode Island. I wanted to associate myself with John Eastman's concern about this version of American exceptionalism. And, you know, in particular, perhaps from an ironic direction, because my concern with the exception approach is that there was another answer to Smith, of course, which was to reconsider our substance paternalism. You know, in other words, there was a solution there that didn't necessarily involve going directly to religion, and that it went to freedom, or to the sense of our ability to undertake these decisions on our own in a community that we would hope is imbued with religious and other views to help us in those decisions.
Your question is?
So my question is, again, with the answer to any of these, without the church working with people for freedom, they get their exception. Where is our protection from, you know, pay for birth control paternalism or this type of thing? Where are people who don't have a religious motivation but have a freedom motivation? We have lost the church as allies.
Anyone?
I think one of the arguments against the free exercise exemption or the religious exemption was illustrated by that Thomas case that I talked about earlier. If he had a philosophical objection to working in the armaments factory, he lost. If he could phrase it as religious, he won.
There is that problem. There were some who will argue, let's expand conscientious exemption across the board to both deeply held philosophical and moral beliefs. And maybe if you make that argument, some have argued you represent an equality of conscience. The court in Thomas said, we're only talking about religion, and construed the free exercise clause that way. But I do think that part of the problem you can have. I mean, I think a lot of people are jumping onto the Hobby Lobby case, not so much out of a concern for religion, but concern of laissez-faire economics, which is what you're talking about, get the government off our back. But if that's your principle, then you're right to say that there's no difference between getting government off the secular person's back and the government off the religious person's back.
Okay, John?
Yes.
I think it's a great question. So I would just add two things. One, some state law objections actually are more inclusive than just a religious objection. So the abortion conscience clause I started with actually says you can object for moral as well as religious reasons. Some state versions of those kinds of conscience clauses will include philosophical reasons. So that's broader, more capacious. I think you would be happier with that. But beyond that, even if there's an exemption that's just for religion, if you have a moral objection, you can go into court and say, wait a minute, that's not fair, right? And sometimes to avoid the possibility of an establishment clause violation, they'll read it more broadly. That happened in the military conscientious objector area, right, where now you can have a non-religious, you know, they're supposed to be sort of worldview claims about or objections to war, but it can be read in a way that's more expansive than the one that comes out of the legislature.
Next question.
Joy Brighton. Kim, I'm just wondering if, given the change that's happening in the world that we're all talking about, if there isn't a point of that we're going to have to define what religion is. Because when we were talking about religious accommodation, and Francois was talking about banning the burqa, which might be religious accommodation, but it also might be a denial of individual liberties if, in fact, that woman has no personal choice of what she's wearing. And I think this difference between personal faith and controlling others, imposing roles on other people, and how, if you're seeing that, if you're thinking that that's something that needs to be defined or looked at, religion versus control.
All right. Kim?
This is not a very satisfactory answer for you, but I just think anyone who's tried to define religion has decided it's too difficult to do. But I guess I'm just willing to live with quite a bit of I called it messiness earlier. I think that yes, when you sit down and try to write down a definition of religion, it's very hard to do. But the courts overall, I think, have done a pretty good job of recognizing when someone is invoking a sincerely held religious belief. And so it'll be interesting to see what the court does with the Holt case that we may hear have a decision in the next month or so, but I just don't think that the way to go to resolve these problems is to start defining religion, because I just don't think we'll get it right. And it also kind of goes to one of the arguments that Smith makes that bothers me the most, is the fact that, well, we really can't have expansive religious liberty because we have too much religious diversity. But that's why we have religious diversity, because we protect religious liberty so strongly. So I'll just go with trying to protect as much as we can, and you know, if the courts will take care of a lot of this for us, I think.
Thank you.
Robin?
So I think that's a terrific question. Can I just say a couple words about it? So we get this question in a different religious liberty context. So when we think about whether family law should depart from sort of the norms at the time of divorce about whether you pay alimony or how you divide property or custody of children, right? Whether you should depart for that in certain religious contexts. So for example, should we have a different norm or allow Islamic families to self-define a norm that would depart from the background civil understandings, right? So seeing that whole debate in Great Britain about the 85 Sharia courts and what should the status of that be. And, you know, I think and I'm happy to share with you an article that shows that there are big rifts between the background outcome under Great Britain's divorce laws and what would happen if, for example, you allowed that Islamic norm to bear. And I think that would leave many women at risk for losing custody of their children. It would leave them at risk for receiving alimony only for 3 months, which is called the adopt period. And they may not have any property at all. Now, I think those outcomes are a crap deal for women, right, and children. And I would not be willing to recognize them myself. But some people want to say that the ladies should not be willing to accept this and that they can simply exit the religion. Now, that's not very helpful, right? Because they can't. They self-identify with that community, maybe the only community they know. They may have relocated to that area, that have barriers to, you know, work, language, every other problem, right? And they're an insular minority within, you know, a Western culture. So just to say exit, you'll get a better result is not satisfactory. That said, if those kinds of breaks with the background civil law are unacceptable, they just are unacceptable, right? And I think we have to say in that instance that they're going to be a floor when we're willing to respect religious liberty. And I think when it becomes a zero-sum game and we're actually talking about leaving women on the social safety net because they don't have this these outcomes as a result of a religious understanding, that that's unacceptable.
Next question.
I'm Kenneth Jost, author of Supreme Court Yearbook, published by CQ Press, and my own blog, Jost on Justice. Judge, you began by mentioning both of the major religion-related decisions from the Supreme Court, and I haven't heard anything said about Town of Greece, and so in the context of the panel topic, I'd like to ask each panelist to address the question whether the decision in Galloway v. Greece is a win or a loss for religious liberty.
I'm going to pass.
You want me to start?
well, actually, I'm glad you asked that question because Bill made a comment very early in the panel that I agreed with, which is there was religious liberty on both sides of that case. And I think the majority came to the only conclusion that it could on both the Establishment Clause issue, which is, you know, the first Congress writes the First Amendment, sends it off to the states to be ratified, and turns around and hires paid legislative chaplains. It's hard to say that legislative prayer is a violation of the Establishment Clause. And interestingly, both the majority and the dissent agreed that Marsh v. Chambers was correctly decided. So that's, I found that fascinating. The other thing that we saw, the other reason I think the majority opinion is right, is that it comes in this very strong strand of free speech, free exercise, and Establishment Clause cases that for the past 70 years since Cantwell v. Connecticut has basically said we do not want government officials parsing private religious speech to decide whether the speech is religious or not, to decide whether it's religious speech but not worship, to decide a variety of things. And I'll just say right now, this is why the court should grant cert in the Bronx household case. It's up on a petition for cert, it's been filed, and there New York City is saying that it will rent to any community group empty public school space in evenings and weekends unless the group is going to use it for religious worship services. They can use it for religious speech, they can use it for religious worship, but not for a religious worship service. And the New York City Board of Education is completely equipped to tell you when your activity is a religious worship service. So I hope that case is granted cert and justice is brought to the churches in New York City. But anyway, I think the majority had to come out the way it did. But I'm very sensitive to the fact that in a pluralistic society and the religious people who may like the prayers being said in the Town of Greece, we're increasingly living in a pluralistic society that doesn't like those prayers. And we need to be people of integrity and be very sensitive to how in the areas where we do have the ability to control some of the speech that we're sensitive to the dissidents or to the minorities or to the other faiths, because we're becoming increasingly, we need that pluralism ourselves.
Bill?
I wasn't surprised about the result in the case. I mean, I think I agree with Kim, because the issue for me on prayer is less should we have prayer or not, but the question of whose prayer. And that's where everything breaks down. Do we want to say, and you can just use picture that in your own mind, and one of the problems that you get is trying to pick and choose whose prayer. Now, what do I think of that decision? It's a Justice Kennedy decision, which means it doesn't make sense. And I think people on the left and the right can all share that view. In that case, what he says, and literally in two lines, one right after another, he says the government can't decide what's a non-sectarian prayer because that does exactly what Kim is talking about. It gets government evaluating religion. And then the next sentence he says, but if the prayer says bad things about other religions or is otherwise divisive, then that wouldn't be okay. Somebody square those two sentences for me because I'm teaching the case next week and I need some help.
Okay. Robin?
I'm okay.
Okay. Next question?
Yes. Thank you, Judge O'Scanlan. Roger Pilon from the Cato Institute. Much of the earlier discussion focused on the difficulty of applying the Hobby Lobby rule, which I think misses the point. And so I'm going back to John Eastman's question. What have we come to as a country where religious liberty has to be treated as an exception rather than the rule? There was a time when freedom of association was one of our first principles. Now we have to defend not associating because of the overlay of a massive body of anti-discrimination law. And it seems to me the real problem is with 1937. In a ubiquitous state, you're going to have to inevitably define what religion is, to go back to an earlier question, in order to get out of the oppressiveness of that ubiquitous state. And I wonder if you would care to comment on that, Bill especially.
Bill, why don't you lead off?
Okay. I'm not going to sit here and defend the administrative state. I will say that the notion that we don't protect religion seriously in this country is just plain wrong. We do a tremendous amount both under statutes. We do it under the speech clause. And we do a tremendous amount under the speech clause. Worship, proselytization. You know, the interesting thing about pre-Sherbert law was so much religious exercise was protected under speech. And so much of it comes under speech. What we're talking about at this particular point is action. And when we get to action, we do get the problem raised by a previous questioner of why do we protect certain kinds of actions motivated by theological views as opposed to some that are motivated by equally deeply felt moral or philosophical. If your point is that maybe we ought to have more conscientious objection in general against the various laws that are out there, I can't disagree with you on that. But the question of whether or not, two things, and the point I'm making in the paper that I'm presenting here today is that the way that they do it in RFRA doesn't make a heck of a lot of sense. You can do it by special exemption. But at some point, you really have to ask this fundamental question is there a difference? And why should we protect just one kind of way of looking at the world and not another way of looking at the world?
Robin?
So Roger, it's just gonna get worse because there's the rise of the nuns, you know, the people who do not now, so many people who do not now identify with a religion. So, and I think Kim hit it on the head. What was once a majoritarian sort of, you know, nice position to be in is now minoritarian. And that is unfortunate because it's in a direct collision with the administrative state and so many religious convictions. And we haven't talked about the kinds of exemptions that are going to allow religious people to live out their lives, right? But at this point, with the same-sex marriage laws, what the kinds of exemptions that we've gotten are bigger than just the clergy. That's not really a fair assessment of them. They go specifically to religious nonprofits, and they're told that they can't have their tax exemption yanked. They're told they can't be excluded from government benefits, and that's all to the good. But right now, we don't do anything for those wedding photographers. We don't do anything for those bakers. And those folks, you know, in a sense, you could say, look, you know, we're just not going to have any Christian or Jewish or whatever people in these professions in a world where same-sex marriage is, if they have deep religious convictions about that. And I think that's really unfortunate. But as we become less and less religious, that means that there is going to be, in Dean Eastman's words, the need to ask for grace.
That brings us to the end of our panel. Please join me in thanking the questioners and our panel for a great conversation.